great privilege of baptizing a young baby, Fleur, and also her sister, Rosa, her older sister, will be celebrating her first Holy Communion. So our Mass this morning begins with the beginnings of the rite of baptism. Dear parents, what names have you given to your child? And what do you ask of God's church to prefer at my You've asked to have your child baptized. In doing so, you are accepting the responsibility of training her in the practice of faith. It will be your duty to bring her up to keep God's commands as Christ taught us by loving God and loving her. You clearly understand what you are undertaking. And God's confidence. I intend to help the parents of this child in their duties to children. The Christian community welcomes you with great joy. In his name, I thank you for Christ our Saviour, by the sign of his cross. And I now trace the cross on your forehead, and invite your parents and godparents to be saved.
Let us pray. God of everlasting mercy, who in the very recurrence of the Paschal feast, kindle the faith of your people you have made your own. Increase, we pray, the grace you have bestowed on us, that all may grasp and rightly understand in what font they have been washed, by whose Spirit they have been reborn, by whose blood they have been redeemed. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The whole group of believers was united, heart and soul. No one claimed for his own use anything that he had, as everything they owned was held in common. The apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus with great power, and they were all given great respect. None of their members was ever in want, as all those who owned land or houses would sell them and bring the money from them to present it to the apostles. It was then distributed to any members who might be in need. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The second reading is a reading from the first letter of St. John. Anyone who has been begotten by God has already overcome the world. Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ has been begotten by God, and whoever loves the Father that begot him loves the child who he begets. We can be sure that love God's children if we love God himself and do what he has commanded us. That is what loving God is, keeping his commandments. And his commandments are not difficult, because anyone who has been begotten by God has already overcome the world. This is the victory over the world, our faith. Who can overcome the world? Only the man who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus Christ, who came by water and blood, not with water only, but with water and blood, with the Spirit as another witness, since the Spirit is the truth. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. In the evening of that same day, the first day of the week, the doors were closed in the room where the disciples were, for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them. He said to them, "Peace be with you," and showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were filled with joy when they saw the Lord, and he said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so am I sending you." After saying this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. For those whose sins you forgive, they are forgiven. For those whose sins you retain, they are retained." Thomas, called the twin, who was one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. When the disciples said, "We have seen the Lord," he answered, "Unless I see the holes that the nails made in his hands, and can put my finger into the holes they made, and unless I can put my hand into his side, I refuse to believe." 8 days later, the disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. The doors were closed, but Jesus came in and stood among them. "Peace be with you," he said. Then he spoke to Thomas, "Put your finger here. Look, here are my hands. Give me your hand. Put it into my side. Doubt no longer, but believe." Thomas replied, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "You believe because you can see me. Happy are those who have not seen and yet believe." There were many other signs that Jesus worked and the disciples saw, but they are not recorded in this book. They are recorded so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing this, you may have life through his name. The Gospel of the Lord. "Put your finger here. Look, here are my hands. Give me your hand and put it into my side. Doubt no longer, but believe." Thomas replied, "My Lord and my God." In the gospel passage that we've just listened to, Thomas has a concrete experience of the risen Christ. He can see him, he can hear him, and above all, he can touch him. And in this concrete experience of Christ, in this seeing, hearing, and touching, Thomas comes to faith in the resurrection. That resurrection of the Lord is a bodily resurrection. It's a material resurrection. It's a concrete resurrection. Not a ghostly or spiritual affair, but absolutely and concretely real. And just as our Lord's resurrection is real, concrete, and absolute, so too our lives as his disciples is called to be concrete, absolute, and real. In other words, our experience of the risen Christ is to have a concrete, absolute and real impact on our lives. And that concrete, absolute and real impact on our lives is witnessed to in the Acts of the Apostles. There we learn in this morning's readings that those who came to faith in Jesus Christ, those who came to believe in his life, death, and resurrection, radically altered and radically changed their lives. We're told in that reading from the Acts that they sold basically everything they had and shared it in common with the other members of the community. All those, it says, who owned land or houses would sell them and bring the money from them to present it to the apostles, to the church. And it was then distributed to any members who might be in need. Now, if I was being literal, I might ask you to do the same. Go out, put your houses on the market, sell the houses, and bring the money here. Not sure that would go down too well. But the point is a real one. And the question and the challenge is a real one. What concrete, absolute, and real impact has the resurrection of Christ, the new life of Christ, had on the way in which you live? When I was reflecting on this question for myself, I asked myself, what are the newest things in my life? And if I have to be honest, the newest things in my life at the moment all have to do with telephones. The new telephone system in the presbytery and the new mobile phone I got just before Easter because my existing contract had run out. And reflecting on those new things in my life, I'd have to be honest that they haven't resulted in a concrete expression of my faith. The telephone system, for example, when you ring it, as you'll discover, gives you a whole list of options. Press 1 for mass times, 2 for the parish office, 3 for the catechist, 4 for the office, 5 for Father John, and I'm at the end for a reason, press 6 for me. In other words, my hope is that everyone will work through all the other 5 before they come to me. The phone system presents a bit of a distance. And it's true with my mobile phone as well. You know, as I've got to get used to it over these past weeks, I've been reintroduced to all sorts of things on my new mobile phone. For example, Candy Crush. And I found myself yesterday in the coffee shop looking at my phone, playing my Candy Crush and spending a good 15, 20 minutes doing it. And this thing, this phone that is supposed to aid communication, aid our being in contact with one another, what it did was the absolute opposite. It took me into my own world, away from everybody else, cut off and isolated. And what's true for me is probably true for many of you as well. Take, for example, your journey into work on the train, or if you go on the tube or you get on a bus. You don't see a whole load of people talking to each other. What you see is a whole load of people doing this into their phones. Cut off, isolated, apart, separated from the world and from the community around. The newness of the risen life of Christ calls you and me to live in communion and community with our brothers and sisters. It's not there to cut us off and to isolate us. Christ rises from the dead that you and I might come to faith and be members of his body the church, that you and I might witness to the world at large, concretely, absolutely, by our actions, to the good news of Jesus Christ, just as those first disciples did, those first believers. Everyone must have looked at them and seen how they lived and what they did. So I suppose I have a simple question. How do you proclaim the gospel of Christ? How do you manifest the life of the risen Lord? And would anybody convict you, not on the basis of your words, of your faith in Jesus Christ, but on the basis of what they see you doing and how you are? Because it's in what we do that we're reminded today that we must witness to the Lord. It's how we are with one another. It's what we do with the things that we possess. All of these ways in which you and I are called to proclaim the risen Lord, the new life that he gives to his faithful. And so let us stand. With confidence, sisters and brothers, let us turn in prayer to the Father, whose Son, rising from the dead, has won for us the forgiveness of our sins. For the unity of the Church, united heart and soul, may we be attentive to each other and to the needs of the most vulnerable. Lord, hear us. For an end to war in the Holy Land and the Ukraine, for those who have been injured and killed, bringing humanitarian aid, and for all the families grieving the loss of loved ones. Lord, in your mercy. For those troubled by doubt, that as he did for Thomas, the Lord will bless those he calls with a certain faith. Lord, in your mercy. For Fleur as she is baptized, for Rosa as she receives her first Holy Communion, that they may grow in their faith and hope and witness to the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. For those suffering in mind or body, remembering especially those who are fearful in their illness, that they will find comfort in prayer and the care and support of family, friends, doctors, and nurses. Lord, in your mercy. For the resurrection of the dead, remembering all those who have died recently, including Helen Akua Adia, Father Michael Daly, David Grundy, Mary Hodgson, Jean Mullen, Caris Newton, and Anna Truglio. And for those whose anniversaries occur at this time, including Bishop James O'Brien, Kathleen O'Brien, and Catherine Mannion. Lord, in your mercy. And so, brothers and sisters, let us call on the intercession of the saints as we pray for this child who is to be baptized. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us. Saint John the Baptist, Saint Joseph, Saint Peter and Saint Paul, Saint Alban, Saint Stephen, Saint Florence, Saint Rose, all holy men and women. If you'd like to be seated.
Spirit of evil, to deliver us from. so that in the sacrament of baptism, all those who you have created in your likeness may be banished from sin and rise to a new birth of innocence by water and the Holy Spirit. We ask you, Father, with your Son, to send the Holy Spirit upon the waters of this body. May all who are buried with Christ in the death of baptism rise also with you to the newness of life. We ask this in Christ our Lord. Fleur Ivy, the God of power and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, has freed you from sin and brought you to new life through water and the Holy Spirit. He now anoints you with the chrism for salvation, so that united with his people, you may remain forever a member of Christ, who is priest, prophet, and king.
for help me by word and example, and bring that dignity unstained into the everlasting life. And godparents, receive the light of Christ. This light is entrusted to you to be kept burning brightly, for this child of yours has been enlightened by Christ. She is to walk always as a child of the light. May she keep the flame of faith alive in her heart, and when the Lord comes, may she go out to meet him with all the saints in the heavenly kingdom. Fleur, the Lord Jesus made the deaf hear and the dumb speak. May he soon touch your ears to receive his word and your mouth to proclaim his faith to the praise and the glory of God the Father. Amen. So let's congratulate. Preparation of the gifts and the offering. Thank you.
pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the oblations of your people and of those you have brought to new birth, that renewed by confession of your name and by baptism, they may attain unending happiness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord. But on this day above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying he has destroyed our death, and by rising restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic host sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Vincent our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen.
At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that our reception of this Paschal Sacrament may have a continuing effect in our minds and hearts through Christ our Lord. Amen. Firstly, thank you on behalf of Father John and myself for your cards, your gifts, and your prayers over Easter. Just to forewarn you, that we have had a new telephone system installed in the presbytery and the parish office. So when you ring, please listen carefully to the options provided and press the relevant button. The new offertory promise envelopes are available for collection from the presbytery for those people who have ordered them. We cannot leave them on display publicly because the labels include personal data. So if you can't pick them up during the week in office hours, please ask myself or Father John after Mass this morning. Also, just to remind you that tea and coffee are available after Mass today in the foyer of the parish centre. Please come along and enjoy some time together. Finally, just to congratulate Fleur on her baptism, Rosa on her first Holy Communion. And we wish you every blessing and a wonderful celebration this afternoon. The Lord be with you. I forgot to say that there is tradecraft after Mass as well, tradecraft in the porch. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Go in the peace of Christ, Alleluya, Alleluya.